shining name of the Lord. As we worship together, let us also pray that God will anoint our souls, our hearts, and that we will be lifted up in Him to give Him praise and glory and honor. So let us come to worship together, singing hymn number 124, Angels from the Realms of Glory. Stand with me to sing.
Thank you.
beginning of Christmas season brings back many different feelings. Our hearts go in all kinds of different directions when we think about Christmas. Some of us go back to childhood and we realize what a blessed time that was that we were able to share in our families growing up, how much Christmas meant. And for children, that means all kinds of different things. None of my family was saved when I was a child. I was actually 17 before anybody in the family was saved, including myself. And so Christmas for me meant work real hard, play real hard on Christmas Eve, so that when you go to bed, you can actually go to sleep. Because if you go to sleep, Santa would come a lot quicker and leave all those goodies. If you lay there awake half the night, which children do in excitement, you know, that night drags on. So I think of those times. I think about the times that Jane and I shared with our own children. And we always shared with them the story of Luke. Every Christmas Eve, we would lay around the fireplace that we had going, and we would share the story of the coming of Christ through the book of Luke. And it was a tradition with us. We always had our traditional, I have a traditional breakfast. Has to be just right. Otherwise, you don't have Christmas breakfast. It's got to be the right thing. And Jane never had that particular tradition or custom, so there was a little bit of change in kind of giving and taking that had to take place with us. But the one thing we all had in common is that the Christ child came on this day, God with us, he was called. And we know that the shepherds were told by the angels to go down into Bethlehem and see this thing which we have told you about. And they did, in excitement. They saw the Christ child right after he was born. And there's a lot of things that come to our mind over that as well. Later on, the wise men came and shared the great gifts with him. A songwriter has written a song that we all know that took place in the late 1800s, that the music was written, say 1871 exactly. The words to it were actually penned in 1865. So it's been around a while. It talks about the sovereign Lord. It's named What Child Is This? And I'd like to sing that for us now.
Just breathe without.
I'd like to have you turn with me today in your Bibles to Hebrews chapter 6. This being the first Sunday of Advent, the gift that God has brought to us is that hope. And therefore I have named this message, Hope, the Gift of God. And together we're going to read from the book of Hebrews, chapter 6. I know it's somewhere in the New Testament, isn't it? I'm going to find it in the Greek. You ever get lost in the Bible?
Yeah.
I get lost once in a while. New Bible. Not used to it. Only had it for 3 years now. Still pretty new. So read with me, if you will, please. Hebrews chapter 6, and I'm going to be reading from verse 13 through verse 20. It says this, "For when God made promise to Abraham, because he could swear by no greater, he swear by himself, saying, Surely, blessing I will bless thee, and multiplying I will multiply thee. And so after he had patiently endured, he obtained the promise. For men merely swear by the greater, and an oath for the confirmation is to them an end of all strife, wherein God, willing more abundantly to show unto the heirs of promise the immutability of his counsel, confirmed it by an oath. That by two immutable things in which it was impossible for God to lie, we might have a strong consolation, who have fled for refuge, to lay hold upon the hope set before us. Which hope we have as an anchor of the soul, both sure and steadfast, and which entereth into that within the veil. Whither the forerunner is for us entered, even Jesus, made an high priest forever after the order of Melchizedek." Today, first Sunday of Advent, the season of Christmas for 2013, is the time which we share the concept of hope. And for the next few weeks, we're going to be sharing together the most blessed of all gifts that were brought by God and given to humanity through the coming and the life and the ministry of Jesus, his Son. Because every year we've shared these gifts as we lit the Advent candles, which symbolize them. And this year we're again going to recall them as they were given and experienced by the followers of Christ from then to now. So rather than concentrate on the meaning of Advent and share God's word for the meaning of Advent, this year we are going to look at the practicality as expressed by the life of those who lived it after Christ ascended into heaven. So today, this first Sunday of Advent, I call our attention to the hope that is signified by the lighting of this candle, which always has been a candle of hope. By biblical definition, hope is a gift of the Holy Spirit which abides as an essential characteristic of the Christian. The Greek word translated hope here in verses 18 and 19 is the Greek word elpis. And it's the same word found in Hebrews 10:23, which is translated faith, and it is the same word that is found in Ephesians 1:12, and translated trusted. So we are looking at a word that contains an entire concept, which we refer to as hope, but under the understanding, or with the understanding, that in that hope also is contained faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, and an utmost trust in him as Savior, as our Savior. The biblical concept of hope that we see here by these verses is not a mere expectation and desire, but includes trust and confidence and refuge in God. Now, we understand hope, don't we? I mean, every Christmas, prior to the time of the actual celebration, have we ever had anybody ask ask us, so, what do you want for Christmas? Do you ever have anybody ask you that? And so we start getting off these lists. There's been years when Jane would have had to rob a bank in order to get me the things that I gave her on my list. But I've cautioned her not to do that, and fortunately she has agreed not to. But from the time we were all children, did not we have our hopes? Oh, I hope I get this for Christmas. I hope I get that for Christmas. I'm so looking forward. And if you watch today's TV commercials, you'll see little children screaming uncontrollably in joy because they have just opened the ultimate gift. Little children get excited because their hopes are that which they trust is going to be fulfilled. But we are older. We understand now, and in the concept of the gift of God, we want to look at hope in a little bit different fashion. Paul refers to the God of hope in Romans 15, 13. So we begin to see that hope has got something to do with God. He also refers to Christ in you as the hope of glory in Colossians 1, 27. And he speaks of the hope of eternal life that is bound up with that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of Jesus Christ, which is referred to in his letter to Titus, chapter 1, verse 2. It is remarkable to be given the understanding biblically of the preeminence that is given to hope as one of the three essential virtues of Christianity for the perfecting of the believer's character. That is faith, hope, and charity. And the greatest of these is charity. But hope is preeminent in that list. It is remarkable because we know that our character, at least all of us, should know our character. And in all honesty, we would almost immediately say, well, I have hope in God, but I would not go so far as to say I have perfect character. Even knowing that the will of God for us is our perfection. Amen? And so we know that we're not perfect. Anybody in here perfect? I'd like to really sit down and talk with you, ask you how you've done it, and I'll model my life after you if you are perfect. Nobody perfect? Well, I guess then we can't model our lives after one another. Perfection is that which God has asked for, and he has given us the gift of hope to help us to gain that perfection of character that he has designed us to live. But hope, we know, is so varied that we would agree that a lot of what is referred to as hope is false hope. The world is full of complaints of the fallacies of hope. So varied is humanity's concept of hope that many are deluded into the activities and the temptations along life's toilsome path that result only in what can only be said to be the grasping of mist when it comes to the end of our lives. And we say to ourselves, what have I done with it all? Have I done anything of greatness or of importance or usefulness to my fellow man, to humanity, that which I'm a part of? And we become deluded if we think that hope is something which is going to just spell out our lives for us without the help of God in the process. We find it easier to say with Solomon, as he wrote in Ecclesiastes, vanity of vanities, all is vanity. What profit has a man in all his labors which he has taken under the sun? But inside of our hearts, we have a very deep call. A call to perfect our character. A call to have hope that we can pass on to other people. We also accept by faith that God never gives a promise without also the provision for his fulfillment. And that's where our text comes in today. That's where our text becomes relevant in the discussion of all hope. So let us consider the text for a few minutes. And in that, the text, by the way, is verse 18 and 19, which says that by two immutable things in which it was impossible for God to lie, we might have a strong consolation who have fled for refuge to lay hold upon the hope set before us, which hope we have as an anchor of the soul, both sure and steadfast. And we'll stop there. So the force of the metaphor in this scripture speaks of an anchor. And the writer to the Hebrews says that we have this hope as an anchor of the soul. Hope here is not the emotion, but it is the object upon which that emotion is fixed. And we can interpret it as such in lieu of verse 18, which speaks of the hope which is set before us and our need to lay hold upon it. So let's just understand that the hope, which is the gift of God, is something which is actually an object and not a means to an emotion. It is a hope or an object which is set before us, and we need to lay hold upon it, the scripture says. And this indicates that hope then is something which is external to ourselves, that it is proposed to us, and it is that which we can grasp. An anchor, we understand, is outside of the ship. That which steadies us cannot be a part of ourselves. For instance, if we were to stand and somehow or another start falling to the left, we would not reach over with our right hand and grab our left hand and pull us back up to a steady position, would we? If we were to start falling forward, we would not put our hands on our chest and push back so that we would not fall forward. Hope is something which has to be outside of ourselves, because the scripture here says it is that which we have to lay hold of. It must be external. Something upon which our fluttering and ever-changing emotions can rest and be still. Now, I might want to explain that a little bit. What is a fluttering emotion? Anybody ever have fluttering emotions? Well, let me explain it to you, and then maybe you'll say, well, yeah, now that you've explained it, I've had fluttering emotions. Fluttering emotions, changing emotions, are that which we do when we don't have an anchor. Let me remind us of the day that Jesus made what we call his triumphal entry into Jerusalem from the Mount of Olives. The crowds were convinced that the Messiah had finally come, God's promised deliverer. Jesus sent his disciples down into Jerusalem to bring back an untried colt, upon which he sat, and everybody understood that only one of true royal blood could ride an animal that had never been broken. And so here he is on this young colt, and he is riding down the mountain, and the crowds around are picked up in this emotion, and their hopes are being fulfilled, because for hundreds of years, 400 since Malachi, the last prophet, they have been looking for the promised deliverer, the one that would relieve them from bondage and grant them their rightful place in the sight of God. And so now on this day of the triumphal entry, they're shouting, Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed be the Lord! And they were celebrating and putting palm branches in and their coats on the ground by way of a red carpet, if you will, for Jesus to enter into Jerusalem. And they were so excited and they were so exuberant that the Pharisees turned to Jesus and said, you have got to tell them to stop shouting like this. And you remember Jesus' reply? He said, if they stop, those rocks will start shouting, "Hosanna to the Son of David." So this crowd, they felt that their hope was being fulfilled. However, a mere 3 days later, down in Jerusalem, at the courts of Pilate, they were shouting, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" That's a fluttering emotion. That's an emotion that goes with whichever way the crowd seems to be going. That's an emotion that goes with whatever direction the wind is blowing. You see leaves in the fall. When they start coming down, a wind will catch them and throw them off in one direction. But around the corner comes another wind and throws them off in another direction. And you can actually watch leaves do a circle. They don't know where they're going, those leaves. You know why? Because they're no longer anchored. And a child of God who is not anchored has fluttering emotions. Whichever way the wind of doctrine blows, they go that way. But later on, if the wind of doctrine is in a different direction, they go that way. And so, when the storms of life come, they react emotionally a certain way. When the good times come, they react a different way. So the emotions come and go. They're in and out. They're up and down. Their pendulum swings a wide swing in every direction. They're either exuberantly happy or depressively sad. Fluttering emotions. We do this. We do this. We have hope. But we need to make sure that our hope is grounded. Against this back and forth, or this fluttering, this up and down emotional life, God's word tells us that we can be stable, firm, unchanging, because we have an anchor. It is not unusual in Scripture, either there or in common speech, to employ the name of emotion to express the object which that emotion grasps. For instance, we can say, "My love," or "My children are my comfort." You see, we are comforted by our children. Well, most of the time. There's times. I've always said during the day, our children were James. At night when they were fast asleep, they were mine. So, our children bring us comfort. That one which we have spent our life with brings us love. And we refer to that as my love or my comfort. But the scripture speaks also of Christ as our hope. In other words, he who excites the emotion of hope is described by the name of that emotion. God is our hope. The Lord Jesus Christ is our anchor, and our anchor is the hope that we have. And so the hope which we possess and which is outside of us, which being fastened to by taking a hold of it, makes us steadfast and secure, is none other than the foundation or the base of our Christian character, Jesus Christ himself. He and he alone provides stability so that we can go straight forward with God no matter what circumstance or storm our lives are engaged in at the time. He is not only our foundation, but also the substance of our hope. He is that which we hope for, and all our future is in him. As a matter of fact, every blessed anticipation that can fill the human heart with gladness is summed up in this, as Paul said to the writing when he wrote to the Philippian church. He said that I may be found in him, a statement which describes the perfecting of God's purpose in his life. Christ is the anchor of the soul, and he is steadfast, firm, and sure, which our text tells us. Verse 19, which hope we have as an anchor of the soul, both sure and steadfast. The two words express diverse qualities of hope. First, a sure anchor is one which does not drag along the bottom. I have had occasion in my life to serve as what I call the dock master. You know, if I was younger, I'd be the boat boy, but, you know, I didn't want to be a boat boy. So I became a dock master. And one day, I had a fisherman who took a boat out, very windy day. He threw his anchor out in the middle of the lake. And I went about my business only to hear through the wind, but I kept hearing it and went down to the dock to see him waving on the other side of the lake. He was on the rocks and could not move his boat. His anchor was not sure. It dragged along the bottom. Our anchor is not too light or too heavy for the ship that rides by it. In other words, we all have different needs. And whatever anchor we need to have is exactly the right anchor for us. I mean, let's put us all in a boat. Harriet gets her own boat. Her anchor can be a certain size. But I'm just a couple of pounds heavier than Harriet. And so if I was to get into an identical boat, I would have to have a bigger, heavier anchor to do the same thing for me that hers does for her. It is to tell us that Christ becomes for us that anchor that we need. Not more than we need, not less than we need. The anchor is one, a sure anchor, is one that has found firm ground and it holds. It does not deceive the crew in the ship, and they may trust it completely. This is a description of Christ for us. A steadfast anchor is one that will not break. It is strong in its own substance. The shaft will not break. The flukes will not break. For those of you who don't know, the flukes are those big things that go out on the side and actually dig into the ground. They will not break. Whatever strain is put upon it, they will not break. I am reminded of Romans 8, 38-39, at which time Paul said, I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, nor height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. He calms the winds that would blow us around, and he stills the waves that would overflow us. He is the Christian's anchor. He is their hope. Scripture tells us that God is able to supply. And we sing a song, will your anchor hold this morning? And that song provides us with an assurance that Christ, our God, is in fact very able and willing and will hold us still in storms. So we don't have to let circumstances and storms change our sense of steadiness or firmness in the Lord. We can go straight ahead. That's how Daniel was able to be thrown into the lion's den and continue on as if life was normal. That's how the three Hebrew children were able to be thrown into a fiery furnace and hold the ground and say to King Nebuchadnezzar, our God will save us, but if he doesn't, we want to tell you and everybody else, we will not bow down and worship this idol. We will serve our God. You see, they were steady. Their anchor was firm. And the other last remaining qualification of the benefit we can get from the anchor of hope is that we need to lay hold upon it. We need to lay hold upon it. Grab it. In other words, let's put our lives in the hands of Jesus Christ. Let's wrap our arms around him and lay hold of him, and he will provide the steadfastness and the surety that we need to handle those storms of life. This is the God that we are asked to remember every time we partake of the elements of the Lord's Supper. Thank you, gentlemen. If you would now please, as the gentlemen go back to their seats, open to the very back of your bulletin, and let's sing together the chorus, "O Come, Let Us Adore Him." So stand with me, would you please? We will sing this and have a benediction prayer, and take 5 minutes and say goodbye to those who are